We are here because we need you, Lord. God, and tonight I pray, as I feel quickened in my spirit, Lord, that your peace be poured out upon your people. Church, I feel this in my spirit right now. God has moved through his singers tonight and brought such a wonderful spirit of worship and peace in this place. And I don't know if you feel better after hearing such great, wonderful singing, but I do, and I feel encouraged in my spirit. But while we're here right now, I feel quickened just for you to just lift up your hands and receive that peace. Sometimes we have not because we ask not. So I'm just going to pray this for whom this is for right now. God, we are seeking for your peace in every situation that we're facing, God. For these battles are not ours only, Lord, but they are yours, God. And you through us makes it possible, Lord, that we can go through any of it, Lord, in this earth. God, and I pray tonight that your peace will comfort the minds of your children. Lord, I feel it in my spirit right now to impart unto them a peace that goes beyond our own understanding. Lord, to be with them in their trials, to be with them in their situations, and that by their being here, that they grow stronger in their mind, Lord, to rebuke the enemy, to resist the enemy, and to dismiss him when he would come against us. God, I bind that spirit of fear in the name of Jesus. I bind against the spirit of unbelief in the name of Jesus. I bind against doubt in the name of Jesus. I bind against the things that would hinder the spirit, even in this very moment, in the name of Jesus. I bind against you, Satan, and what you're trying to do to God's people. We are here and called to walk in peace. So we receive that peace tonight. Somebody say, I receive.
I receive.
Just as you believe it in your heart and desire it, the Lord said it's yours. If you'll take it, we receive that peace tonight, oh God. Glory to God. My Lord, my Lord, my Lord. My Lord, my Lord, my Lord. He got my shoulder out of my community, oh, son of my high. Oh, somebody needed that more than I thought they did. Glory to God, I praise you for what you're doing, Lord. God, I feel the wheels turning in this place.
Oh, I thank you, Lord.
We're so glad all of you are here tonight. And I hope you feel refreshed in your spirit. And I hope just to add a little bit of a spark to the oil that God has been pouring in you tonight. That out of that spark become a flame. If you have a Bible, or if you can find one, I would encourage you tonight to read these scriptures with me. And I've got a very intriguing word for you that I am thankful for. Amen. While you're getting there, let me just testify to you for a minute. When I was younger in my life, I didn't truly understand how much that God cared about me. I didn't see how much He was involved in my life. And even in times where I failed, I didn't realize or see where His hand was. Even when I didn't believe in Him, I didn't see where His hand was. And I know sometimes we think that people that do not believe in God do not receive blessings of God. But I'm here to tell you, if you pray for them, God's hand is upon them. And if you love God and you pray for them, He's going to bless them. Why? He's a merciful God. And He doesn't want everybody to perish. And I'm so thankful tonight that when I didn't have anybody else, that God stepped up and said, I want to be His father. I want to be His mother. I want to be His spouse. I want to be everything that He needs in His life. You see, before my life was ever put back together, there had to be a substance in between me and who I was and the things that God had for me to hold it all together. And we're about to read about what that substance is. Aren't you excited tonight? I'm telling you right now, God has a special word for you. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, starting at verse 2. Well, we'll start at the beginning, if you'll humor me to read for a little while. And if you think I'm taking too long, then why? You just come up here, get the mic, and we'll let you preach. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 1 says, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, and have not charity, I am become as sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains and have not charity, then I am nothing. Amen. Powerful.
Amen. Yeah.
Powerful.
Yes.
Amen.
Wow. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, oh, we're about to have some church here in a minute. And though I give my body to be burned and have not charity, it profiteth me nothing.
Amen.
Charity suffereth long and is kind. Charity envieth not. Charity vaunteth not itself, is not puffed up, doth not behave itself unseemly, seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil, rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in the truth.
Yeah.
Beareth all things, believeth all things, hope all things, endureth all things. Charity never fails.
Amen.
Can we just say that one together? Charity never fails. But whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away. Lord, I feel His presence moving in here tonight. When I was a child, I spake as one, and I understood as one, I thought as one. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know even as also I am known. And now abideth faith, hope, and charity, these three. But the greatest of these is charity.
Amen.
Here's the word that God put in my spirit that caused me to seek for this scripture. Love will make the difference. Love will make the difference. I think about every sin of my life before I gained salvation. And I see all of my faults and my failures and my mistakes. But then, now that I look back, I can also see the good part of my life that I have become today. All the joy that I now possess. All the wonderful peace that God gives when I don't understand everything. All the blessings that I don't deserve. And all His grace that I get to walk in even though I don't deserve to walk in it. And I begin to think about that there was something that happened in between the person that I was and the person that I become. And I realized that it was love that was in between who I used to be and the person that God transformed me to be. And I found that out of the sacrifice of Christ, He gave the ultimate price of love so that we can all be transformed out of the person that we were into the person that we are. We are no longer as we used to be, the person that we used to be. When love came on the scene, the person that we used to suffer under, the flesh that used to rule this thing, no longer had dominion. When the perfect love came and broke every chain and caused every fear to be moved out of my life. So I am glad for every single time that love has come to make the difference in my life. I'm glad for those old timers that used to testify when I was a young man.
That love me enough to pray me through out of my
addiction, because I fear that if people call upon us in this day to help pray for people through their addiction, that we only care about it as much as our natural person wants to care about it. Let me ask you tonight, do you know there is a difference between the burden of your flesh and the burden of your spirit? Do you know there's a difference in what you carry and what you're upset about at your job versus what you wage warfare in the spirit? There is a difference between a natural love and a love that God has put inside of you. And the evidence of it in you is how you love people. Brother, I want to be spiritual. Amen. I want you to as well. But it's not driven just by tongues. It's not driven just by prophecy. It is driven by a legitimate, sincere concern for your brother that costs you yourself.
Amen.
Can we just go ahead and pull the band-aid off and dig underneath the scab and get in there where it hurts a little while? Can we put a little salt on this for a little while? I begin to think about how that we get so busy that we lose our supernatural concern because it is being dulled by the senses of our flesh.
Yes.
And due to the lack of prayer that we have oftentimes from being so busy, the love that we know that we could have for others is not in there. Now, that doesn't mean that you're not an individual that doesn't love people. When you look at your children, you couldn't help but think of nothing but love for them, right? So that's not to say that you don't have love inside of you. But what we're talking about tonight is the kind of supernatural love that when it is interjected in a situation in between somebody's sin and on their way to their deliverance, that it will be enough for them to pull them out of the fire and set them into being a new individual.
Yes, blessing.
You see, love is the glue that holds it all together.
Yes, it is.
I wrote a book on this about 4 years ago. God's spiritual glue in your life is love.
Yes, it
is. The evidence of how you're going to hold things together in your life is solely defined. And I said solely, because it said that you have faith and hope in you. But the greatest of those is your love. God wants you to have such a love for other people that you would prefer to have them blessed over you being blessed. The scripture put it like this: greater love hath no man than this, that he would lay down his life for his friends. And I began to read some of these scriptures, and I just began to be amazed. And I don't know if you see it like I'm seeing it right now when I read through this. And it says, though I have a gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I can remove mountains and have not charity, I am nothing. Now let's just be real about our individual walk with God.
Yeah.
If we have the power to remove mountains out of people's lives, but don't have the love to go out and actually do it, then we are held accountable and will bear the burden that they would have borne. Those that know to do much, to not do it as well. And he said, to whom who would gain much knowledge, that much is also required. So let's put this together. Jesus paid a price that he didn't have to. To lead us out of a situation into a new hope. And if Jesus lives inside of us today, that means that his same love in us is enough to help other people from our love to cause them to come out of their troubles. I can tell you all the times when I was growing up, how that I would come to church and the way that people looked at me predominated the way that they loved me. The way that people would judge me was greater than the way that they loved me. The things that they knew about that I did, all they wanted to see me was on the altar repenting. I could feel it. I don't know if anybody's ever been there that you failed before and you were afraid to ever come back to church because of all the things that people may have said about you. But I went through a whole lot and was afraid to return to church because of what I had done in my life. And the times that I did try to come back, I'm here to tell you, it's not against any one individual, but judgment was greater than love. If you've had that experience, I wish you'd say I did too. get to a place where we know that God loves us in spite of how people will treat us.
Amen.
And we can get to a real relationship.
Yes.
You know, I love you all dearly. I really do. I pray for you. I care about your lives. But let's just talk about this in the perspective of marriage. There can't be any one person more important than the one I am choosing to love. And if I put anything in between me and that person that I love, then that would be considered an adultery, right?
Amen.
Now, we don't want to look at it like this, but I'm going to go ahead and tell it like it is. We are in a relationship with God, and we love Him.
Yes.
And there should not be anything that stands in between our relationship with God. Because when it does, the way that it comes out of us, it shows that we love this more than God. Have you noticed the pews are not as full anymore these days? Have you noticed that people's desire that once had it no longer possess that longing and desire to be in the house of God? Is anybody else noticing this? There is a draining of the love of God that is occurring in people. Why? Because every evil deed that He tempts us into, that the enemy does, that love that we have for others, that love that we have for ourselves, is drained dry. If you've ever went through a dry place, say, I sure have. If you have ever felt dry, you've been drained.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't mean you have to stay that way.
Right.
If you've been in a relationship and they got rid of you, even for the wrong reasons, that doesn't mean it has to stay that way. If your marriage is on the rocks and you think there's no hope, I'm here to tell you, it doesn't have to stay that way. You see, God wants to intervene. And I feel this tonight. God wants to intervene and begin to put in that substance in your life that will cause what you were to become who you are.
Yeah.
Without that kind of love, we won't make it. Can we go into chapter 14 for a second? Let's read that first verse. Follow after charity and desire spiritual gifts, but rather that you may what? Prophesy, encourage. We must learn, first of all, that there is no single thing more important in your life than God's love in your life.
Amen.
Yes. Amen.
There's not a thing.
No.
Everything, and let's talk about gifts in the sense of what you can even do as a job.
Yeah.
What you can do as a job isn't still as powerful as God's love in your life.
Amen.
Because you can be the most amazing CEO at any company, but if you don't have God's love in you, you'll be one of the next ones that commit some kind of crazy act to siphon money out of a company or to make bad decisions when that person should have never made those decisions. You see, there's a lack of love in the world that we live in. You don't have neighbors like you used to have neighbors. You don't even have Facebook friends like you used to have Facebook friends. They read one post you read, that you write, and then they call someone else saying, can you believe what they wrote on there?
Mm-hmm.
I can't believe what they posted on there. Can you believe the nerve that they had to put that on there? Why are they even thinking that anybody cares about what they had for breakfast? I'm going to go ahead and tell you. It don't matter what you have for breakfast. What matters is if you prayed this morning.
Amen.
If you are going to have a loving relationship with God, we're nearing this, we're on the holiday, so I'm taking this as a good opportunity to talk about how we love on God. Is that all right? If you want to have a loving relationship with God, you have got to be intimate with God. How do we become intimate with God? We bless Him with our praise. Oh, thank God somebody finally said it. I thought we were never going to say it. You know, your praise and worship does not matter about the song choice. It is all about how that you are loving God. I don't just choose to hold hands with my wife just because I choose to do it, because I love her and I want her to know I love her. I don't just raise my hands just because the Bible told me to.
Just because religion said that I'll do it, I do it because I love my God.
And I don't know if you've ever encountered where you made a mistake during Valentine's. Maybe you forgot to get the flowers on time, or maybe you forgot to book that reservation, or maybe you even forgot that it was Valentine's Day at all. Maybe you've been in that place where you forgot to show that love. Now let me tell you something. The kind of people that get upset about you missing one day of the year telling them that you love them are superficial.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
Because I found that when I give flowers when it's not a holiday,
amen,
means twice as much as when I do,
amen,
when it is a holiday.
Amen.
The times when I say that I love her and do something nice when I don't have to seems to have more bearing and more meaning than it does when I do it just because I have to. Yeah, it's important to remember your anniversary, and yeah, it's important to go and have your anniversary dinner, but it's more important to have consistent intimacy,
amen,
in your relationship than it is just to go through the motions.
Amen.
So worship is showing God how we love Him. It is not emotion. It is not a hand in the air.
Yeah.
It has nothing to do with what you do with it.
Mm-hmm.
It's how you do it.
That's right.
Yeah.
Because we all praise Him differently.
Yes.
And I would never want everybody to praise God the same way, because God didn't make you to praise like me.
Amen.
He didn't make you to be like me.
Amen.
He called us all to be beautiful and handsome and amazing individuals, so that when we chose to love Him, it would be special.
Amen.
If that were not the case, He would have made us all the same.
Right, amen.
But He gave us all a different, unique quality.
Yes, He did.
But all of them are rooted and grounded in His love.
Yes. Yeah, amen.
There are people that are attending this church that need their loved ones saved.
Yes.
Yeah.
You didn't think I was going here, but we're going here. There are people that are struggling right now.
Amen.
You might have all your loved ones saved, and I say, praise God.
Yes.
What I want to ask you and challenge you about tonight is to begin to dig into that same love that was shown to you when you were saved, and to begin to understand that you should love your neighbor,
amen,
like you would love yourself. Because when you do that, you're not just proving your love to another individual.
No.
You're showing God how much that you love Him,
amen,
by how you love others.
Amen.
You see, I don't think that He brought Jesus Christ back for us to take advantage of His grace.
No. Amen.
God doesn't want us to be an adulterous church.
No.
Oh, I feel this in the center of my soul right now. He doesn't want us to come in and love Him when we have to, and then go out and have some other thing on the side. He doesn't want us to come and just do it because it's the motions, and then be miserable all week long. He wants us to have an intimate connection. Well, how do you establish intimacy? First of all, you communicate. Somebody said, you got to
talk.
Sometimes talking will bore you to death. But you got to understand, if you don't get what's in you out, then over time it will come out of you in an unexpected way.
Yes.
That's why God wanted us to bring our issues to Him.
Yeah.
So that it didn't bubble up and come out against somebody else. Now, I've been guilty of this myself. Be too upset about everything else, and then when somebody needs me, I'm not able to produce in season.
Right.
To be instant.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
And I've been ashamed of myself not being able to produce instantly in season. But that's a direct reflection on how that my intimacy is not where it should be with God.
Yeah.
So number one, we're going to write these down, I hope. How do we be intimate with God? Number one, we communicate.
Yeah.
Right? Number two, we obey selflessly. Okay? If we just come in and just do it because it's what we did last time, then that's not true love. It's not true love. We don't need more than four people to in here. No more than even two, the Bible said, to have real church.
Amen.
Have you ever wondered why it's so hard sometimes when you've got an entire crowd of people? It's because there's a lot of people that are battling with things.
Yeah.
that is predominating the lack of love in God's people. And we don't even have enough strength in us to be able to love greater than their issues. How do you know that you're not loving greater than their issues? You're judging them. You're judging them. We look at the passage of the Good Samaritan. What made that powerful was that he stopped being in different culture and ethnicity and race and everything, not wanting to help in a normal situation. But the love in him kicked in.
Amen. Amen.
The love in him kicked in. And that's what church is to be.
Yes.
It's not religion.
No.
You see, religion will have you every single Sunday. And I'm not even sure how many nights we have things going on, but he would have you to be here at every single thing, doing every single thing you can do. But that's what I like about verse 8. It says, charity never fails.
Right.
It says, whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they'll cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. Can I just add a couple more to that? Whether there be church services, they'll bomb out sometimes. And whether there'll be preachers, they're not going to give you what you need sometimes.
Right.
Whether there be great singers in the house, they may not be tapping into the anointing sometimes. But the one thing that will not fail you is God's love towards you.
Amen.
Amen.
We communicate. We obey selflessly. And then we what? Show affection. Lord, I love you. You may not see where God is, but you know how you give God a great big hugging kiss? You praise him.
Amen.
You praise him when you don't have to. You praise him when it's not conventional. You write things that exhort God, that magnify him in your workplace, in your personal life, wherever that you are. Our lives should say, I love him. Wherever we are, our lives should be speaking, I love God.
Yes, it should.
Even when we don't speak words, our very countenance.
Yes. Yes.
Amen.
Our very countenance.
Yes.
I don't know. I don't know if you've ever been in this place before, but if you've been close enough to somebody that you can just look at them and know that there's something up.
Yeah.
Yes.
You're close enough to somebody where you know, uh-oh, I've really done it now. Mm-hmm. And you get that look.
Yeah.
Nothing against you, I'm just changing. Oh Lord, what have I done? Oh Lord, what have I done?
Yeah.
We might think it's some great discourse or punishment that we face that God's going to slap us on top of the head when we are not acting like we should be.
Yeah.
But our punishment now is that we have not because we ask not. The only thing that we ever suffer through is a lack of something. If God came to be your strength and your weakness, then all we have to do is have a relationship with him for that to kick in.
Yes.
If prophecy exists in all of us, say it's in every single one of us, if encouragement exists in us, then all that we have to do to make it come alive is to have God's love in our life. There are people that are seeking for others, other relationships, other people to share their life with. There are people that are coming out of relationships and need a new relationship. Now I'm going to give you a very strong piece of advice. You might be praying for God to arrange to have the right person brought to you, that everything that you think is going to fix everything. But let me give you a piece of advice since God is putting this in my spirit. The only thing you need to learn how to love is him.
Amen.
Yeah.
Because when you love God, he will love you back.
Amen.
Somebody help me preach. He won't go home tonight. If you love God, he'll love you back. If you'll just praise him through your storm, then like Job, you'll come out with double than what you started with. If you'll love God and trust him anyway and be faithful, like Joseph, you'll come out of slavery, you'll come out of bondage, you'll come out of a situation that was falsely brought against you and be made more than royalty.
Amen.
Amen.
So if you know somebody that's seeking for another person in their life, if it's you, I want to give you this teaching. Learn to love God first.
Amen.
The scripture teaches us that if we will seek Him first, all these other things will be added to us. And I know that sounds profound, that if I just love on my God by studying scripture and coming to church and being obedient, that He could supply me another person to love. But I'm here to tell you, as led by the Holy Ghost, that is absolutely the case. My Lord and my God, here's the issue, and here's why He doesn't want you to try to do it. Because you have poor judgment.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
Amen. Oh, yeah. I'm not just preaching this for those sitting here tonight. We're going to put this on the internet for some people that are looking for a significant other. I'm here to tell you tonight, if you want any good thing in your life, just learn to love God.
Yes.
Just learn to love Him.
Amen.
The enemy would make how you love God feel like it's almost impossible to do.
Yeah.
How does He do it? He keeps us out of our intimacy by making us to be busy, right?
Yeah.
So we don't have enough time to get down and pray and say, Lord, I just want to thank You that You gave me another day.
Yeah.
And then, you know, one day turns to two, and 2 days turns to 2 or 3 weeks. And then we go through 3 or 4 things, and we just simply don't think anybody cares at all.
Yeah.
Because our perspective gets changed as we yield to how we suffer. But if God's love come for all of us, that we would not perish, then that means no matter what you face, His love will be there.
Yeah.
Can I read one more scripture to you tonight? I'm trying not to take too long, but I feel this so strong in my spirit. Oh, thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord. John 3. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son.
Yeah. Amen.
Can we just stop right there?
Amen.
For God so loved you that He gave you Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
What kind of love that we look over? We want to celebrate eternal life. That's great. I'm looking forward to going to heaven. I don't know about you. But think about that God loved you enough to give up His own Son for you. What a love. So when we consider what we can give that is godly love, that's what I'm referring to as supernatural love. Will you give up and yield to Jesus in you? This is good stuff right here.
Yes, it is.
Will you be willing to bear your cross?
Yes.
And out of your love and obedience for others, that they can be saved?
Awesome.
I couldn't tell you how many times that I felt like when I preached it was pointless.
Awesome.
I'm just going to be real. I couldn't tell you how many times that I sang that I sat down and thought, what did I do? I couldn't tell you how many times that I spent over 3 hours in an altar service to get up and walk up and say, well, did I even help at all? The devil is coming to destroy the love of God in you. Because if he can take it out of you, then you won't be doing supernatural things.
Right.
Scripture told us that we don't even fight against flesh and blood.
No, we don't.
But the devil will sure make us think we do.
Yeah, yes.
If God said He'd make our enemies to be at peace with us, guess what that means? They're going to be drawn by your love.
Yes.
And if He was going to cause us to forgive 70 times 7, what is going to cause us to forgive? Love. And if He's going to cause us to be able to turn the other cheek, even when we would be struck, what kind of quality does that speak about us?
Amen.
Verse 17, for God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. He didn't save us to condemn the world either. He saved us that through Christ, through us, people can be saved.
Yes.
What defines Your impact as a Christian is how much you love people.
Yes.
And I'm talking about looking over much, forgiving much,
amen,
giving people opportunities. There's been some people that have been to churches I've been at that weren't in a good place. And it just seemed like time and time again they were in failure after failure after failure. And it seemed like the people would come up and say, "What do you think about that, brother?"
Yeah.
How long do they get to be allowed to fail before God chastens them for their actions? And I begin to think about how much that God loved us through our whole life before we confessed. And the Lord began to deal with me about giving people their second chance.
Yeah.
If we can even get them in the church,
yeah,
we ought to not cast one stone, but be inviting to bring them to salvation. But let me tell you, it's not very likely you're going to win them here. Can I go ahead and just say that? We're not always going to win them here. Guess where you're going to win them? Here. Going out there. The way that you carry your love with God will speak volumes about how you can love others and make an impact to them.
That's true.
If I didn't have a supernatural love, I would never have a concern to pray for other people. If your prayer life is only about what you seek for you, then you need to examine how that you're loving in a supernatural way, or what goes beyond just what you want. You see, God wants you to be so content in your love with Him that your prayers are no longer about what you want, but about what He wants through you. If it was about what I wanted, do you think I'd be here?
No.
No. I'd be sitting at home like the rest of the people that's already given up. If it was just what I wanted, I pray, "Lord, give me a comfy bed to sleep on at night. Fill up my cupboard that I never have to go to the store. Pay my car payment for me while you're in it too. Love you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus." That's not no love.
No, it isn't.
God ain't your sugar daddy.
No, He isn't.
He is a God that is over and sovereign over everything.
Amen.
And He has authority over you. Did you know that?
Amen.
You don't even rule your own life.
No.
Lest God give you the authority.
Amen.
God has just been, man, I'm telling you, He's been transforming my perspective so much.
Yeah.
And He's causing me to realize that to be the most effective of a Christian is that everything you do has to be given out of love for every single person that's around you.
Yeah.
That there is no grudge worth keeping.
Amen.
There is no ill thoughts worth bearing towards one another. Yeah. That there is nothing worth carrying more than the burden of their soul to be saved. There's nothing greater to carry. Everything else you're carrying is just junk when compared to getting somebody to receive God.
Amen.
There's nothing that compares to that. And I know you're thinking, "Man, this sounds pretty hard for a Friday." I'm here to tell you, I don't think the Sunday crowd could probably handle this. That's why I'm giving it to our Friday folks. You can tell this from Mr. Friday, preacher really brought it. Sometimes you got to go easy on people that are just starting. But to whom I know and whom I love, I'm going to tell you the truth, right? That's what I have to do. And I want you to do the same for me. But more than that, even if I never said another word, here's what I'm closing with. I say nothing else. My brothers and my sisters, if I never see you again, I want you to know one thing. I love you.
Amen.
I love you.
Amen.
I care about you. And I'm concerned. And I want you to grow. And it doesn't matter what I say up here. If you don't know that I love you, it doesn't matter. You got to know I love you, and I do. You've got to understand that until we can learn to love each other in that supernatural way, we'll never prosper doing it all our own ways. We've got to learn to love each other so that we can love those that are broken. I never want to see another person to commit suicide, but it's happening right now. I don't want another person to give in at a party to drugs when they're tempted just because they're lonely. I want them to have a way of escape. And we are those people. We are those people. We are the Stevens that stand idly by to be stoned. that has ever been made on my life has not been a story without love. Every good thing that somebody's done that has changed my life, it's because they loved me. When I was saved when I was 15 on an old Wednesday night, just about a night like this, somebody that wasn't even my family came to me, asked me if I wanted to pray. And that night I prayed through, never to be the same. And even though I had my struggles, there were people around me in my life that loved me until I was able to get established. And now that I'm established, I'm not forgotten the love that's been given to me. And if I can, I'll do all that I can to bless you. I come every time that I get here to bless you because I love you. You know there are people today that would long to hear what you're hearing right now. They long to be in a service to hear such praise and worship. I go to the nursing home all the time and see people that, oh, they just long to have their kids show up. They never come. I'd see people all the time that are just lonely, that need somebody in their life, and nobody's there.
Amen.
You are to be that bridge.
Yes. Amen.
God's love is the substance that makes your faith and your hope have worth.
Amen. Amen.
If you feel like God don't love you, you're not going to be very faithful to Him, right? Let's put that in a human perspective. If you don't feel like that your mate loves you, you're not going to be trusting in them. You're not going to be depending on them. You're not even going to be interested in talking to them. God loves you.
Yes. Amen.
He loves us all so much that He even gave us a language to speak to Him.
Yes.
That is where your tongues come in. He gave us a language to communicate. He loved people enough that even when they didn't have the understanding of tongues to save them. And He loved you enough that when you were willing to yield to His love greater, that out of your belly, it's not something He's got to put in there. It's already in there. I just want to clarify. It's already there. And as you realize your connection with God, you're going to have, wow, what an intimate connection you can have with God. I never thought my whole life I'd ever speak in other tongues. But when God delivered me, I felt such a love and power over me that it came out naturally. I don't know if anybody's ever had that experience. I didn't think about it. I didn't wonder about it. It flowed out of me. Because I felt His love around me so much. I felt so free from His promises as I finally just yielded and said, God, I believe in salvation. I believe in deliverance. I believe that You're here to deliver me today. And as He was moving in the moment, His love started flowing out of me. When you love someone, it's going to come out of you. You're going to do things outwardly. Oh, I couldn't tell you all the times that I've heard couples that have called me and talked to me and said, I just don't think He cares. And then you ask the person accused, well, when's the last time you got something nice for them? I don't know. It's been a while, but they know I love them. Uh-huh. You think?
Uh-huh.
And I feel like that's what God asks us sometimes when we come in and just waste His time. Do you love me? The scripture talked about, I believe it's in Revelation, about how we can fall away from that first love. And like I said, there's many pews in here that should be filled with people. But love has been lost. And they feel disconnected with God. We are the connection. God through us, we are the connection. Our obedience to people is the connection. Sometimes I don't know if I'm making an impact at all. But I love you enough to try.
Amen.
And you've got to understand this one thing. You can ask for everything else in the world. And I encourage you to pray for the things that you desire. But until you have a connection with God that you trust Him and depend on Him greater than anything else,
Amen.
Then we're seeking vainly.
Amen.
And guess what? God will love you enough. He'll let you have things sometimes, even when you don't need it. Sometimes we have to learn. One time I prayed for a better job, but I got it, but I didn't realize how much harder it was going to be. And then I had to grow up to it and figure it out. And I became stronger. I didn't want to stay there, and I didn't. But I learned to pray more sharply. Oh, accurate. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Accurate. I'm making sure I'm not leaving anything behind tonight. If you forget everything else, you just remember this. Love will make a difference.
Yes, it will.
I'll do a book. Love will make a difference.
Amen.
And I love you. Appreciate you all. And I don't say this often, but I thank you for putting up with me.